You're listening to the audio production of Gentle on My Mind, In Sickness and in Health, with Glen Campbell, by Kim Campbell, published by Thomas Nelson and read by the author. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperchristianaudio.com.
Introduction: My Life with Glen. Glen and I loved dancing together. I loved how he held me in his arms. I loved how we moved as one. "You're the dancer in the family," he told me. "I spent my whole life on the bandstand, singing and playing my guitar, watching other folks dance. I never had the chance to dance." "You're a good dancer," I assured him. "If you forget what comes next, just follow me." And he did. Glen danced through life with me for 35 years. Sometimes he led, sometimes I led. It didn't matter. When God brought us together, we became one flesh. Glen knew that dancing was not only my passion, but my therapy. At the most challenging moments of my life, I turned to dance to express myself and work through my pain. I asked God to transform my grief into motion and cover me with joy. Each time my prayer was answered, the poetry of Psalm 30 sprang to life. "You have turned my mourning into joyful dancing." As a young woman, I began my professional life as a dancer, not realizing that there is something healing, even sacred, about bodily movement, attuned to music, and tempered with grace. To be filled with grace is evidence of God's holy presence. At times of great suffering, it's easy to lose awareness of that presence. Dancing always brought that awareness back. For me, the dance metaphor goes deep. For this story, the dance metaphor is necessary. I say that because although life with Glen entailed monumental struggles, those struggles were ultimately mitigated by movement. I came to learn that love, like dance, is all about movement. Love is never stagnant or motionless. It bends, bows, and stretches. It expands and grows. Its essence is flexibility. Its beauty is divine. As a source of inspiration, dance strengthens me. Enduring the enormous challenges placed before me required inspiration. That inspiration is rooted in love, but a love that can adapt to changing circumstances. A love, like dance, that is supple, and yes, a love that is divine. As you will soon see, this story is shaped by extreme emotions: fear and hope, pain and jubilation, despair and gratitude. If I write from a gentle place, it's only because I serve a gentle God who has given me the grace to put pen to paper and share with you a journey that has brought me closer to Him, and a goodbye that keeps Glen by the rivers of my memory, ever smiling and ever gentle on my mind. Chapter 1, Unprepared. It was my first and only blind date. I was blind to the excitement surrounding the man I was about to meet. He was blind to the young woman he had been told was attractive. I remember the date, May 28, 1981, because it looms large as the moment my life changed forever. In a few weeks, I would turn 23. I didn't know Glen Campbell was 45. I didn't know much about him at all. I knew his name, of course, but at the height of his fame, when he starred in his own national TV show, I was 10 years old and only vaguely aware of him. I didn't read the tabloids and knew nothing of his tumultuous romances and difficult divorces. I had no idea he was fresh off a 10-month knockdown, drag-out affair with fiery country star Tanya Tucker. Had I known, I might have bowed out before I bowed in. Sometimes ignorance is bliss. In this case, ignorance led to bliss. The city was New York. The occasion was a James Taylor concert. James Taylor, along with the sublime Joni Mitchell, was an artist who always inspired me. The blind date had been set up through my friend, Lynn Williford, whom I had met my freshman year at East Carolina University. Lynn was Miss Majorette of America, and in many ways, my role model. I'd been head majorette of my high school, but Lynn, with her dazzling twirls, spins, and spectacular behind-the-back catches, performed on another level. She was also stunningly beautiful, outrageously long eyelashes, big Bambi eyes, and a sweet disposition. I guess you could say Lynn and I both fit that elusive all-American girl category, although Lynn was in a category all her own. At the 1981 Azalea Festival, she had been crowned Miss North Carolina, where she had the honor of introducing Glen Campbell and his band to the adoring throngs. That's where she met Carl Jackson, Glen's banjo player. They stayed in touch, and a few months later, the Campbell crew was in New York. Lynn and I had also moved to the city where we were pursuing careers in dance. My world was ballet and Broadway, Mikhail Baryshnikov and Bob Fosse. Yes, I admit it. I loved Liza Minnelli. I also had a crazy schedule, ballet classes in the morning and dancing two shows a day with the Rockettes at Radio City Music Hall. I even managed to squeeze in a jazz class in between shows. I was dancing 7 hours a day. I weighed 101 pounds and ate a pint of Haagen-Dazs every day. Ah, the joys of being young. Through Carl Jackson, Lynn made the arrangements for our date. For the first and only time, I told my dance captain I was sick and couldn't make the evening performance. To be brutally honest, my main motivation was to see James Taylor. I was far more a fan of folk and southern rock than mainstream country music. At the same time, I knew that Glen was a star. The prospect of meeting a star is always alluring. I was curious. The date was unconventional, but then again, everything about my life became unconventional. Why should our first encounter be any different? Carl and Lynn took me to the Waldorf Astoria where Glen was staying with his parents. Carl said earlier that day Glen had taken his folks to see Mickey Rooney and Ann Miller in Sugar Babies. I was impressed. Glen was apparently a good son. We went up to his suite where we waited in a lavish living room. Only a few minutes passed before he burst into the room singing Rhinestone Cowboy. Quite an entrance. Quite a man, I thought. He was tall, blonde, and handsome. His sandy hair was perfectly in place. His soft beard was neatly trimmed. His light blue silk shirt mirrored his light blue eyes. His zippered boots were crafted of black ostrich. His voice projected an intoxicating mixture of mellifluousness and enthusiasm. When his eyes met mine, I felt myself melting, just a bit. And then a bit more when he said, "Carl, why didn't you tell me she was so pretty?" Music to my ears. It didn't sound like a line, though. Glen sounded sincere. His sincerity, in fact, was so strong, along with his sexiness, that while I was normally a composed young woman, I felt nervous, shy, and even intimidated. The presence of his parents took off the edge. Like me, they came from a small country town, down to earth, good-hearted folks without a bit of pretension. They made me feel safe. Dinner at Peacock Alley, in the marble-columned, palm tree decor lobby of the Waldorf, was somewhat overwhelming. Until that night, the New York I knew was a city of coffee shops and delis, where struggling actors and dancers like me dined on tuna fish and meatloaf. Peacock Alley was the epitome of elegant refinement. I did not feel elegant. I did not feel refined. But I did feel a magnetism coursing between me and Glen. Was I inventing that dynamic? Was I fantasizing that this man seemed to be as drawn to me as I was to him? Maybe, but maybe not. During dinner, he couldn't have been more solicitous. He peppered me with questions about my past. His queries weren't pushy. They were genuinely sweet. He seemed genuinely interested. I wished I had known more about his career, but he was happy to keep the attention on me. When the food arrived, Glen bowed his head and said a simple blessing. That humble gesture caught me by surprise. Without hesitation, I asked Glen, "Are you a Christian?" "Yes," he said, with a note of honest conviction in his voice. At that moment, I flashed back to something that had happened a week earlier. I had been walking down Fifth Avenue with two girlfriends I had danced with in Disney's Broadway show, Snow White, before landing my current job at Radio City. With a fairy tale involving a handsome prince in recent memory, we were wistfully wishing for the man of our dreams. One of them offered up a prayer. Dear God, please send me my Prince Charming. The other friend looked up and said, Dear God, please send me my knight in shining armor. When it was my turn, I thought about it for a minute and then half-jokingly prayed out loud, Dear God, please send me a handsome Southern Christian, millionaire to fall in love with. Now here I was, having dinner with a handsome Southern Christian millionaire. Was meeting Glenn a serious answer to my half-serious prayer? It was starting to look like it, especially when we arrived at the theater where flashbulbs were popping, paparazzi were screaming Glenn's name, and fans were reaching out for autographs. Glenn put his arm around me protectively and ushered me to our seats. James Taylor was great. He sang Fire and Rain, Sweet Baby James, and all his beautiful songs. I must admit, it was hard to focus on James Taylor while sitting next to Glenn. Glenn was 6 feet one, and in his younger days, he had trained to be Mr. Albuquerque. He still had that muscular physique. His deep and resonant voice commanded my attention. I was smitten with his smile, his voice, and his smell. Afterward, Glenn escorted me backstage. James greeted Glenn like a long-lost friend. Glenn introduced me like a newfound friend. As we walked to the exit, Glenn stopped, gently pressed me up against the wall, and kissed me. The kiss was long, passionate, and heavenly. I was breathless. I felt like I was dreaming. I was seated in the back of the limo when Glenn kissed me again. I didn't resist. I couldn't resist. The lights of Midtown Manhattan illuminated Glenn's face. This is the best first date ever, he said. For me, too, I had to admit. I'd been on many dates with surfers and frat boys, but I had never felt like I'd been on a date with a grown man. Glenn was a grown man, and then some. Back at his suite, though, the sweetness of this dream date began to sour. Glenn began to drink, and drink, and drink some more. The evening, begun on a light cloud of charm, was suddenly darkening. I fought the darkness. I didn't want to see what I was seeing. This man turned me on. I wanted the turn-on to last. I allowed a few more kisses, and yes, I was aroused. But no, I couldn't deny that he was sloppy drunk. Then he whispered in my ear, I want to jump your bones. I pulled back. What? I asked incredulously, hoping he did not say what I thought he said. I want to jump your bones, he repeated softly. I had never been spoken to that way before. I felt vulnerable and a little frightened alone in the room with an intoxicated, much older man. I could see I was in a bad situation and had no business remaining there. It's getting late, I said. You go home now, you'll never see me again, he warned. I was shocked. Right in front of my eyes, my Prince Charming had turned into a big, fat toad. As for the Christian millionaire I had prayed for, without Christian values, all the treasures in the kingdom could not persuade me to stay. I decided to ignore his remark and to make my way to the door as gracefully as possible. I enjoyed meeting you and your parents, I said with a smile. Thank you for the concert. As the door shut behind me, I didn't know what to think. He had begun the evening as one person and turned into another. Little did I know that transformation would become the central and most critical challenge of our relationship. That first night, I was convinced there would be no relationship. And yet, minutes after arriving back at my apartment, the phone was ringing off the hook. I'm sorry, said Glenn, his voice now soft and strangely sober. Maybe he had been drinking coffee. Maybe he had come to his senses. I want to see you again. I want you to know how bad I feel for the way I behaved. What could I say? What did I say? I said, well, I appreciate the apology. And I'd appreciate a second chance. Let me at least take you to dinner tomorrow night. I'll be on my best behavior. You better, I said, half jokingly, half seriously. My head was filled with misgivings. My body was filled with longing. My spirit was filled with confusion. This man was all at once wonderful and bewildering. He had displayed exquisite manners and then turned vulgar. I wanted to dwell on the exquisite.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.